The 1980s was a very interesting time, not least of which for the development of the floppy disk. Consequentially, things like the BBC's floppy disk system is not as straightforward because there's a bit of history with changes in the floppy disk structure. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to split the floppy disk videos into two parts. One that deals with the hardware and the control side of things, and the second one that deals with the command structure and how to use it on the command line. So let's get stuck into the hardware. We're going to begin our education into disks with the good old 5¼-inch disk. In the mainframe world, we were working on larger 8-inch versions of these, but it was the 5¼-inch version that made it into the home. The disk itself, inside here, is a circle of plastic coated with a magnetic coating, and it's on the magnetic coating that a head is able to both read and write to the disk. When you put it in, a hub will come up and grip the central ring, and that is one of the things that enables it to turn the disk. Here you have an access window, so the head can go in and out, and by the combination of the in and out and the rotation, any point on the disk can be accessed. Here we've got a very interesting hole in the case, and through that you can see another hole in the plastic. When this hole goes round and is visible through this hole, that sends a signal to the controller that the disk has done a rotation, and that's how it enables it to time where the disk is. Off to the right you've got a write protect notch. If you used a piece of tab to cover that, then the disk would be deemed write protected and it would stop any writing to it. But that's basically the physics of the disk. On it there are 40 concentric tracks. Now think of these as like the rings in a tree. They're concentric. They're not like the tracks on a record where it's just one long track winding around. They are 40 distinct tracks. There's 10 sectors out on each track and 256 bytes per sector. That roughly comes out to 100k of storage, which is about 3 times the Beeb's own memory. Now they developed it further, so they managed to get more tracks on the same disk. So that was 80 tracks. That was still 10 sectors, 256, and that more or less doubled it to 200k of storage. They said, okay, well, we've doubled the density of that, so they called the 80 track double density disk and the 40 track single density disk. Now there are some physical characteristics of the disks. Not too bad on the 5¼, but major stuff on the 3.5, as we'll come to later. When it came to sides, it wasn't long before people noticed that there was actually a coating on both sides of this. So by turning the thing over and carefully cutting another hole on the other side here, you could actually get two sides out of this. So you could literally swap it over and put it in and get two sides out of it. Later, of course, they invented double-sided discs, but that was to come later. That's the 5¼. Here's the 3.5. As you can see inside the disk, this is inside, you can see the plastic. This one's dead. And they've improved the mechanics for literally rotating it, so it was more accurate. That was the start, and you'll notice it's even though it's a small size, you've still got a suitable, and the right areas are not too far off each other. So that was the 3.5-inch disk, and initially the first 3.5-inch disks that came in were also double density. Now a double density disk is, this is a double density disk here. You'll notice that there's a write protect here that, when you slide it in, protects the write area, the read write area. That's on a spring, and you have a little notch here that you can put up or down to make the disk write protected or not. As is always with these things, they didn't stop here, they went further. And the 3.5-inch disk then became the high density version. I don't know exactly what they did with the tracks, but the BBC wasn't using the high-density discs. By the time that high-density discs actually came into being, the Beeb had moved on to the B+ Master and Archimedes. So the control on the Model B never really saw high-density discs. It was either 5 1/4 in single or double density, 40 or 80 tracks, or the 3.5-inch disc in double density. Now the other important thing that I've got to sound is that this is a high density disc. You can see it's got an extra notch, and it's also got the letters HD on it that mark it as high density. So what happens with these discs is you can't really use a high density disc as a double density. The reason being is because they've got changes in the layer. It may look the same, but there's changes in the magnetic structure. So if you try and record and cover that up and fool the disk drive into thinking it's writing to a double density disk, the recording you'll make will not be very reliable, because it will be using different voltages and different strengths of magnetic pulses to record the information on this. So if you're going to go into BBC and use 3.5-inch disks, you will need the double density disks. Obviously, what then happened was that they included double-sided. So rather than being single-sided discs and having to work them over, they became double-sided. So the drives themselves had two heads, one at the top and one at the bottom, to read the discs. And eventually, these notched up in terms of space that was stored on a single disc. The 4080 track aspect of this did cause some trouble on the 5 1/4-inch discs, because that was the medium that a lot of companies were putting out their games on once they started switching off tape. And what you'll typically find with a lot of the commercial media out there is that they generated the one disc, but they layered the information on it in such a way that it could be read regardless of whether it was put in a 40-track drive or an 80-track drive, which was quite neat. When you think about it, they managed to get around that quite neatly, and that was pretty much how they got around it. But in general terms, if you're looking for a disk drive, if you're looking for a 5 1/4-inch disk drive, my advice would be to go for a 4080 track switchable, so you're able to read both media if you need to. I have to admit that if you've got no need for it, if you don't need to read the older media, then my advice is to forget the discs altogether, because some of them are getting very hard to find and some of them are getting more expensive. This box of double density 3.5 inches, for example, cost me now about £1 a disc, whereas previously there was something like 10 pence or something like that, or sometimes even cheaper. And like I said before, you can't really use the high densities in there. It's a different magnetic structure. So that's pretty much the difference between the 4080 tracks and how they got around it. I didn't see a lot of media deliberately brought out on the 3.5-inch floppies, and because they were double density anyway, you didn't have to worry about the 4080 track thing, because they were 80 tracks anyway. So how did it all happen? Well, it started with a number of drives. And it started with drives 0 and drive 1. This is before the days of double-sided. So you had two drives physically connected to it via the one cable. If you're used to a PC floppy disk arrangement, then you'll know that by a very simple twist in a small part of the cable, that is what helps define between 0 and 1. So you have the cable coming in from the computer, and then you have the cable going into the next one, and you have in here a very small twist in a small section of the cable, and that is what enables the system to identify between drive 0 and drive 1. Later on, they went for double-sided, which meant that they had to make that 2 and 3. In the computer, you can select between these drives by drive 0, drive 1, drive 2, and drive 3. So if you've got something like one of these in here, in one drive, you can select between the top, side on drive 0 and the bottom on side 2. Obviously, with the double-sided of a disk, you can only store about 400k on one disk, even though in a PC a double-sided can store more than that, can store about 700k bytes. In a BBC, it can only store 400k. That's not a lot of information, but it depends on the information you want to hold. And obviously, you could do things like separate the program on one disk from the data on another disk or on another side. You've got options, but this is basically how the whole thing hangs together. If you've got hold of a BEEB, one of the first questions you'll want to know is whether or not it's got a disk controller in it. Now, although the BBC by standard came with only a tape controller and the disk option was an added extra, many of the BEEBs that are out there have got the disk chips in them. Although there's a number of chips that make up the whole disk system, one of the telltale chips is this one here. And it typically comes in one of two major variants. The old style is like this one, which is an 8271, which was manufactured by Acornsoft, and it was pretty much the first chip that was out there. Watford Electronics came up with a 1770 controller, and that was a later controller which Acorn were to use on their later systems, like the B+, the Master, and others. But for the BEEB, the most common is the 8271. You can upgrade these units still if you can find the chips. But if you take the lid off a BEEB and you want to know whether or not it's actually got a disk system in it, this is the quickest way of telling. Just take the lid off, look to see if you've got a chip there, and see what it says on it. One of the two numbers, 8271 or 1770, and that will tell you what the controller chip is. Of course, if there isn't a chip in that socket, then your BBC is unfortunately tape only. The chip itself is the controller, whereas you're probably used to things like hard drives or other devices which are self-contained. The same isn't true of the old floppy system, because much of the control is undertaken by that chip. The timing signals come back from the drive and are transmitted back to the chip, and it's the chip that actually does the controlling. One of the key problems that people find trying to hook up modern 3.5-inch floppy drives, which are relatively easy to get hold of, hooking one of those up to a BEEB, is that the modern 3.25-inch drives, not all of them, but some of them, transmit a timing signal back that the chip can't understand, and that causes a bit of grief. Fortunately, there are some products available to get around that and hopefully make the whole process a lot easier for you if you can find them on the internet or eBay or somewhere like that. This is one such device, as you can see, BBC Micro Floppy Interface. On one side of it, it goes back to the BBC with a standard flat ribbon cable. None of the ribbon cables here need twists, because it gives you two outputs, one to one drive and another to another drive, X and Y. So each of these just goes straight off to one drive. In between the two, you can see a chip here, and that takes care of the timing problem. You've also got power for one of the drives. I've had to power the second separately. And you've got jumpers here which allow you to change the order. So you can have 0 and 2, 1 and 3, or 0 and 2, 1 and 3, just by switching the jumpers rather than having to mess around with switching the cables themselves. As well as the chips that control all the hardware itself, there's another chip called the DFS chip that actually deals with talking with you, the user. And that's the DFS chip. It normally sits in one of these five user bays here. And this is ours, once it refocuses. The disk filing system chip comes in, for the Acorn system, two major versions. You have 0.9, which is actually what's installed here, or the later version, which is 1.2. Those are pretty much two of the most common chips you'll find. Unfortunately, 0.9 being the earliest version, you'll see another chip here, and that contains a supplementary chip with lots of extra commands that didn't come as standard on the 0.9 chip. The 1.2 chip, funnily enough, has some of those commands on board. Some people who are buying second-hand BBC micros are finding a problem when they come to use floppy disks. You see, some of them have got the Acorn disk filing system installed. That's the DFS chip that we looked at, as opposed to the Advanced Disk Filing System chipsets. And some of the earlier chipsets don't actually support the format programs. Instead, what happened was when you bought the floppy drive, it came with the utilities disk. You load the utilities disk in, load the program to do the formatting, swap that disk out with the disk you want formatted, and let it do its job. So if you buy a BBC with a disk drive and you haven't got that utility disk, you could find yourself in trouble because you won't be able to format any new disks. Fortunately, there are some solutions. There is an ADT chip, which I think it's acronyms to Advanced Disk Toolkit or something like that, that somewhere like Retro Clinic can sell you, and that contains these commands on it. The thing you need to watch for, of course, is in the Beeb you've got five user ROM sockets. One contains the operating system, one contains BASIC, and if one contains your disk filing system, that only leaves you two. And if you need to install the ADT chip, that leaves you with one. So you're narrowing your options. It's something to be definitely very aware of. There is a partial solution by using sideways RAM, and we'll discuss that in another video later on. So to recap what we've gone through so far, when the floppy disk entered the home market, it was at the 5.25-inch stage. It could store 40 tracks on it, which equated roughly to about 100K. As it developed, it went to 80 tracks, which doubled its density, hence double density, single density, SD, DD. And it also went from single-sided to double-sided in the drive, to one head to two heads, without having to needing to turn the floppy disk itself over. When the 3.5-inch floppy drive came in, it was already at double density. But by the time it had gone to high density, the BBC was basically left behind in terms of development. And for technical reasons, you can't reliably use a high density disk as a double density disk. You really do need to be using double density disks, and these are starting to get a bit more expensive and slightly harder to get hold of. The floppy disk drives themselves are controlled by a controller chip which is inside the Beeb. The two versions, one by Acorn Soft, the original, and the 1770 by Watford Electronics, which was the later version, and that was used in subsequent machines like the Master. The timing issues exist if you try and use a modern 3.5-inch floppy drive to the controller, but you can get hardware solutions for that. Finally, to use it, you need a DFS, a disk filing system chip, and there are various versions around. The Acorn Soft, the two common ones, 0.9 and 1.2. There are other DFS chips for the Watford Electronics, and there are yet more chips around for different file systems, but they're a lot more rare. And the format command is a particular thing that you need to watch for as to whether it's on the chip or whether it would have been supplied on a floppy disk, because the format command is what will enable you to format new disks ready for use. So that's roughly the hardware side of it, and the next section is going to be how to control it.